welcome you all this morning. Thank you for making it through the storm and the wind and the rain and getting out of bed this morning. It was a hard one, wasn't it? It was a great sleeping in weather. Would you pray with me, please? God, we praise you and we thank you for the opportunity to worship. We may be few in number, but our spirits are big in you as we wait for what it is that you're going to do in this place today. God, our hearts are open. We want to hear what you have to say through our music, through our word, through listening to your scriptures, God. Bless us as we bless your name. Amen. Please be seated for our brief announcements this morning. They're not brief at all, actually. We've got tons of announcements this morning. It is next Sunday is what?
Men's Day.
And that means also that it is, we call it Men's Day, but it's really Women's Day. Men will be handling the service so that women will be off. And you can just sit and watch. And in the praise group, that's going to mean especially you. I'll use this for now and I'll get it right later. We have a special speaker next Sunday. Reverend Mitchell Jones is going to be with us. He's written a book, The Journey to Authenticity. And he's a fellow that's made the journey that so many in our society have to make, from being partnered with the wrong person, the wrong gender perhaps, to somebody that God really intended for him. You know, many of us get forced into that little narrow canyon where we're told that we're supposed to be, and we're being dishonest, not only to ourselves, but to everybody else. Well, that's been his journey. He was on Ayanna von Sant's show and wrote a book and is now really working toward authenticity. I think it's an important story that he has to tell us. And so he will be preaching at both services next Sunday. Also on Saturday next week is Out Raleigh. Never been to it before, but I hear it's a good one. It's down on Fayetteville Street. We have sign-up sheets out front for people that are willing to be at our booth and to represent us for Out Raleigh next week. So if you are going to be there and are willing to sign up for an hour or two on the schedule, we really ask you to do that. Even if you're not signed up, if you're in the area and you want to drop by and shake folks' hands and greet them as they go near the table, we would really appreciate that. We also have sign-up sheets out there for people that are interested in training to do different parts of our worship service. We are going to be expanding the folks that you see up here on Sunday morning during worship. We don't want to just strictly be about deacons anymore, but we want to encourage people in the congregation to also be a part of the prayers of the people, to be a part of reading scripture. I'm a pastor that has more scripture read than some do, and so we need more readers to get through it. So I want to invite you to do that. We also we're going to be training folks eventually on how to serve communion and do other things. So we really want to expand our capacity for worship because we believe that God's going to also expand our numbers. We're offering worship training on two Sundays right now, May the 23rd and June the 26th. So if you're going to be in service either one of those Sundays, and want to stick around afterwards. Currently, there's no other meeting scheduled, so that's not a conflict. And we invite you to come and be a part of that, and we'll train you in the different parts of worship that we're trying to encourage people in. If you're interested in that training, please sign up outside so that we'll know that you're coming and that we'll be able to plan and have the right number of handouts and all that good stuff. On this Wednesday night, or our service on Wednesday night, we are going to, on our Potter's House service, it's on May 4th, so what do you think it's going to be about? May 4th? Star Wars, May the 4th be with you, is the sermon title this week. Vance has been playing with it and working with it for a while, so if you're a Star Wars fan, or even if you're not, if you want to come see just how crazy Wednesday night services can be, we invite you to come this Wednesday night, and May the 4th be with you. Also, we have a yard sale coming up in June on the 18th. We still could use lots of donations to make it a successful yard sale. So if you are somebody that cleans out your house often, or if you need to clean out your house often as I do and get rid of things, you know, when your coffee tables start looking like things are going to fall off the edges, it's time to get rid of some things, to pass them on to someone else so they can love them just as you do. So please make donations for our flea market. We'll be receiving them here at the church office all the way up to the 18th. Now if you would rise as you're able, and we'll pass the peace of Christ with one another.
Like praising him. I feel like praising him. I wanna praise him in the morning, praise him all day long. all day long. I feel like praising, praising Him. Come on and praise the Lord while you have a chance.
You are. worthy to be praised this morning.
Good morning, saints. We have a little saying in practice here, so bear with me.
Right?
Bow your heads and pray with me this morning. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for waking us up this morning and planting purpose on our hearts as we traveled from near and far to be with each other today in your presence. God, there's so many things on our hearts, and as we come before you, we ask that you cleanse our hearts and give us only what we need to serve you. Remove and clean anything out of our storage closets that we no longer have use for, or for that no longer serves us. God, as our pastor comes forth today, I ask that you hide him behind the veil. Allow the words that he is speaking to us to be saturated in our hearts and our minds, from the top of our head to the bottom of our feet. Allow us to be able to receive what is being fed to us so that we can do the work that you have called us to do. In your precious Son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Touch my heart, Lord, speak through me. If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me.
You can use me, Lord.
If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me.
That's our prayer.
If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me. Take my hands, Lord, and my feet.
Touch my
heart, Lord, speak through me. If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me.
We have two scripture readings today. The first one is Acts 16, 9 through 15. During the night, Paul had a vision. There stood a man of Macedonia pleading with him and saying, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." When he had seen the vision, we immediately tried to cross over to Macedonia, being convinced that God had called us to proclaim the good news to him. We set sail from Troas and took a straight course to Samothrace the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia in a Roman colony. We remained in this city for some days. On a Sabbath day, we went outside the gate by the river, where we supposed there was a place of prayer, and we sat down and spoke to the women who had gathered there. A certain woman named Lydia, a worshiper of God, was listening to us. She was from the city of Thyatira, and a dealer in purple cloth. The Lord opened his heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. When she and her household was baptized, she urged us, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my home." And she prevailed upon us. The second reading is from John 5, 1 through 9. After this, there was a festival of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now in Jerusalem by the sheep gate, there is a pool called in Hebrew Bethesda, which has five porticos. In these lay many invalids, blind, lame, and paralyzed. One man was there who had been ill for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had been there a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. And when I am making my way, someone else steps down ahead of me." Jesus said to him, "Stand up, take your mat and walk. At once the man was made well, and he took up his mat and began to walk.
Take me back.
Take me back.
Please take me back.
Take me back, dear Lord.
To the place.
To the place.
Where I
first received you.
I wanna go back.
Take me back.
Please take me back.
Take me back, dear Lord.
Where I first believed.
Can we sing that one more time?
Take me back. I wanna go back.
go back to where you first believed. God will give you a second chance. God will give you a third chance. All you got to do is have faith. By faith, we'll make it.
Amen. Thinking about going back, taking back, going backwards, you may have noticed some poster board on the walls when you came in this morning, different colors. That's our congregation, St. John's Timeline, out on the wall out there. And many of us came in at different times. In fact, some of us, I understand, came in more than once. You know, that we may have come in at one point and then needed to take, well, this is a cynical way to look at it, needed to take another lap around Mount Sinai before we could come back. Or we had some other things that we needed to do in the way, or somebody or something got in our way here and it just didn't seem like the right place. But after a minute or two or a year or two or sometimes 10 years, we decided to make a journey back. So you can acknowledge both of those because there are lessons in both of those. Some of the strongest and finest leaders that I've seen in our movement anyway have been those people that have known when to walk away and known when to come back. Amen. That's an important thing. So what I want you to do on the timeline out front, I think it's still on my jacket, is to take one of these little rainbows and put your initials in it or write your name on it or whatever you're going to have enough space to do. I apologize if you have a long last name. There are also some little tags there that if you have a hyphenated name or a long name, you can use them instead. But I want you to place yourself on that timeline of St. John's MCC so that we can remember when it is that we came in. My name's already up there. I come in 2016. I'm a late bloomer. But some of you may have come earlier. And then as we, over the next month or so, we're also going to add some other things to that timeline. I'm going to need your help, Cindy, with some of them. But I want to put things on there like the Bible studies that we have that were really important to the growth of the congregation, the different events that we might have had, the different celebrations that we might have had. And somewhere along the line, when we get enough on there, we're also going to start looking at some of the difficult things that we've been through as a people. I mean, this is a blessed congregation. I think you know that. I was here for your 40th anniversary. There are very few congregations, especially in MCC, that in 40 years have only had four pastors. That's a remarkable thing. God was with you. Two for 5 years, the first two, one for 10 years, then our last pastor, settled pastor for 15 years. Reverend Boone was here, and that's a pretty remarkable legacy. Somebody else reminded me this week, and we're trying to get pictures of all of them, but how many key leaders in our movement and the fellowship have come out of this church? There are people that have gone on from here to pastor churches in Denton, Texas, in Norfolk, Virginia, in Orlando, Florida, in Houston, Texas, right over in Durham, right here at home. Still, Carlton didn't go very far. He went down to Durham and came back to be here with us pastoring. Brendan is down in Florida, and I'm sure that God's not finished with Brendan yet. But God's movement has come out of this church, and God has blessed the world through this church. And we want to acknowledge that because that's all important information. It's especially important as we build for what God is going to do next. Would you pray with me, please? God, I thank you for the history of St. John's. And I thank you for what is yet to be. I thank you for the burning of each of our hearts that tells us that there's something more, that you are calling us to still more greater things in you. God, bless us. Give us ears to hear. Give us eyes to see. Silence the other voices so we might be prepared for you. In Jesus' name, amen. We're continuing today in our readings in the book of Acts. And the book of Acts is kind of a weird thing in the New Testament. It's not a letter. It's not a gospel. You know, it. Some people look at it as a book of the history of the early church, but it's not even really a history because it's still, it's an intentional telling of a story in order to make a point. If you get into some of Paul's letters, the very people that they're writing about, he doesn't agree with the order of things that the author of Acts, who many people think was Luke, is saying. He says, you know, well, that's not exactly the order it happened in, but as Luke tells this story in the book of Acts, he has an agenda. You know, most of us have agendas. Can we be honest? Most of us have agendas in what we do and how we tell stories. You know, when Mother caught us doing something we shouldn't have been doing, we always had an agenda to say, well, I wasn't even there. Or, have you looked at my brother? His hands are dirty. Of course, they were dirty all day. His hands were always dirty. But you could always say, you know, look at Dan. He might have done this. Actually, it was the other way around. He was the one who was always telling on me, even though I didn't do it. And somehow, I was the dumb big brother that always managed to get caught, even if he'd been doing it for 3 hours. Mother would walk in when I was doing it. You know, that's the way it happens. But we have agendas. We do things in an intentional way, and this story isn't told in an intentional way. And right at the beginning, Luke gives us the outline of what this book is going to be about. Jesus said to the disciples, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you." That happens on the day of Pentecost, right at the beginning of the book of Acts. "And you will begin be my witnesses in Jerusalem," that's a small place, a town, "in Judea," which is all of the territory occupied by the Hebrews, "in Samaria," a territory that was just beyond Judea, where there were people that were half-breeds, if you will. I always think about Cher's song, you know, half-breed. They were people that had been left behind during the deportation, and so they'd intermarried and then picked up some other gods and some other beliefs along the way. And you know how it's we as people always want to have us and them. Well, they were one of the thems. The Samaritans were a them. And then it says, "and to the ends of the earth." And at the point of the book of Acts that we're at right now, we're beginning to discover just how far the ends of the earth are going to be. We've already heard stories about Philip preaching to the Ethiopian eunuch, which was somebody who had come into Jerusalem but was on his way back home to Ethiopia, and Philip preached to him, and we believe that the church that sprung up in Ethiopia and survived there until the Crusades was probably planted by that one eunuch, that one individual. And then beyond that, Peter begins by going to Cornelius, the eunuch, and preaching to him and sharing the story. And Cornelius was a follower and was living in Judea, but he certainly was a Gentile, and yet the good news is shared with him. And now this week it goes even a little further, because Paul gets called outside of the territory where they'd already been. Paul gets called away from Judea, away from Samaria, onto a place where they had not been before. Paul has a dream, a vision during the night, and it's during the night. Some of these visions happen in the daytime, but this was actually in the form of a dream. And he saw a man from Macedonia, a Greek man, and the man said, "Come over here, Paul, we need your help." Now, this man from Macedonia wasn't like somebody saying, "I need you to come help me in Chapel Hill," or "I need you to come down to Charlotte," or even "I need you to go to Asheville." "I need you to get in a boat," is what he's saying, "and I need you to come all the way over here to me," which is more than a single day's journey, which means actually an overnight in Samothrace, and then going to the port city of Neapolis, and then going even further than that. You know, it's an intentional journey. And if you read later, one of my favorite verses in Paul's journeys is when he talks about all the bad things that happen to him when he's traveling. You know, if my travel experiences were as bad as Paul's, I think I'd stop, wouldn't you? He'd been bitten by snakes. He was beat up. He was in shipwrecks. He, you know, got thrown overboard. All kinds of things happened to Paul along the way in his journeys. And this was just the beginning. This one seems to be a fairly uneventful trip, and he makes it directly. One thing I wanted you to notice there that I kind of skipped over, Paul has this dream alone, but when the journey starts, there's a we there. He's traveling with somebody else. We might get a dream or a vision, but we alone can't do it. Amen? We might have a dream, but that dream has to be shared, and we may need companions to make it possible for us to travel. Paul kept a companion with him. He had Apollos for a long time. They had a falling out, which was actually a good thing because it meant the gospel went in two different directions instead of staying in one. And so he's just recruited one new recruit, Timothy. We also know that Silas was around during that period. So this could be one we, or it could be three we's, or it could be however many it took, but they were traveling in a traveling party by the time they were on that boat, by the time they went to Neapolis. Now, when they got to Neapolis, and I have to be honest about this one, that is a beautiful port city. You know, it's like us going over to the beach. You know, it's a place that you might want to live. Recently, the pastor position in Rehoboth Beach, Delaware, was posted, which is a beautiful, gay-oriented beach town in Delaware. I'm sure they're getting a lot of applications for that pulpit, amen? People want to go to nice places. When Topeka, Kansas came up, I don't think as many people applied. You know, even though it's a bigger church, I just don't think that that was as popular. Sometimes we'd like to think that God, I do have a commitment with God, a promise from God that someday I'm going to get to live at a beach. Hasn't happened yet. I'm only 62. But so far, you know, I was invited to go to Long Beach one time as an associate pastor. I was just sure that I was supposed to go. But the more I prayed and the more my partner prayed, that wasn't it. And that was one of the hardest no's that I've ever had to say to something. But anyway, he had the chance to stop there at the coast, but instead he went up to this stinky big city, Philippi. Now, I don't know how bad it was, but I know it was a major city, and some people just don't like major cities, amen? I happen to be a city kid. I like sidewalks. I like buses. I even like rats sometimes. You know, I like the things that come with the city because it also means there are other people like me, lots of them, and there are restaurants and all that. But not everybody can handle the city. When Baltimore came up, not everybody applied for Baltimore. You know, they'd rather be in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, out in the middle of Amish country than they would to be in the city. But different people are called to different places. They go to Philippi. And there's a hidden gem in here that you would miss. It says that it is a leading city in the region and that it is one of the protectorate cities of Rome. So rather other than just being a leading city in that region, it also is a part of the Roman Empire. And it also then has probably some communication links with other parts of the empire. So Paul was pretty intentional and pretty deliberate when he went to Philippi because he knew that from that place he might be able to share the word better. So in that place, he gets there. He's had this dream of a Macedonian man. So he probably walks the streets for a couple of days looking for this Macedonian man, and nobody shows up. It says that he had to wait. How many of you are good at waiting? There were probably at least one or two of you, and I praise God for you because that's not me. But he got there, and you know, Peter had had this vision of somebody coming, and immediately three emissaries come, and immediately he goes to Cornelius' house. This isn't that story. He has to wait. And when Paul typically goes into a new city, he goes to the synagogue and finds an opportunity to preach. Well, there's no indication that there is a synagogue in Philippi. You had to have 10 observant men in order to have a synagogue in your town. And there may have only been 9 there. There may not have been any. Or even if there was a synagogue, there's no record of that. But if there was, Paul was not invited to speak there. It could be that it was hard ground, if you will, that it wasn't a place that he could go to speak. So instead, he goes to a place outside the city wall. And this is one of my favorite verses in Scripture. It really is, because it's always intrigued me in its implication. He, on the Sabbath day, we went outside the gate by the river where we supposed there was a place of prayer. And we sat down and spoke to the women who had gathered there. How many of you ever heard of gaydar? You know, that's something we used to say that we had. Nowadays you don't need it because we're everywhere, but back then you really needed it. And I remember being in Albuquerque, New Mexico with an ex of mine, and we were with a tour guide that really didn't want us to leave her house. It was kind of scary at one point. He ran away, and I got stuck there for a couple of extra days. But we went to this market. Actually, we weren't in Albuquerque. We were in Taos. We'd been through Albuquerque. We flew out of Albuquerque. But I looked over at this building, you know, pretty blank building on the front door, no rainbow flag or anything. I said, "That's a gay bar." And she said, "There aren't any gay bars in Taos." That didn't sound right. He said, "No, there's no sign that that is." We looked at the tour guides, there weren't any. I said, "That's a gay bar." It was. It was. The two days that I got stuck there, the day I finally managed to get out, I went there, and yes, it was a bar. It was there. I was in Tallahassee, Florida one time, staying at the Hilton, which is right down on the main square. And I went to the front desk, because I sometimes would do, because there usually was at least one of us at the front desk. And I said, you know, is there a gay bar around here? "Oh, no, we don't have any of those in Tallahassee." That didn't sound right. So I walked out the front door, made a right, made another right. There it was, in the same block, just right behind the place where I was staying. You know, that we have that scent. Paul had spidey sense, if you will, here too. He could somehow find this place of prayer. He used his intuition to discover this place. But sometimes we don't have to have intuition. Sometimes we do it by research. Sometimes nowadays we use the internet, you know, or we look, or we ask people where other people are, or we ask around, or we do whatever. But in this, they supposed, however they supposed, I think we need both pieces. We need the research people, we need the evidence people, and we need the intuitive people to come together and help us find the opportunities that are out there. And this is one of those opportunities that at that moment they could only suppose was there. The other thing that's intriguing about this verse to me is that it was all women. It doesn't say it's all women, but it says the women who were gathered there. You know, he was looking for a Macedonian man, and he found a group of women. And I'm sure walking up on them, he had to say, "Why am I here, Lord?" You know, I can remember going to MCC churches early on in my connection with MCC, and there were some churches that were men's churches, and there were some churches that were women's churches. And three of us went one time to MCC Baltimore back in the 80s to promote a weekend retreat program, and we were pretty much laughed right out of town because we were the only three men there that day. There were about 60 people, and we were the only three men. We had come ill-equipped for our mission that day. We had sent the wrong folks into the wrong territory. I went down one time to Chattanooga, Tennessee to start another one of those weekends. And then I ended up not being invited to go along on it. But again, it was sponsored by Huntsville MCC, and it was all women. And they felt that having people, mostly women, on that weekend would work well. I'm one of those weird gay guys that attracts more lesbians to my congregation than I do women, than I do men. And Pastor Deb, who was here a couple of weeks ago, is the opposite. She's a lesbian woman that attracts more gay men than she does. We both say, you know, we were put in the wrong bodies, but it works out okay. So... But at any rate, here he was with these women. And now I have to shift over to this woman, Leah. It is likely that this was her gathering. It's likely that she is the senior person in the gathering. She is a head of household. She is a small business owner. She's from the city of Thyatira, and she's over here probably as a sales agent for the fabric that comes from Thyatira. Thyatira is known for their purple fabric. It's kind of a reddish purple, I understand. Today it's called Turkish red fabric, and they still make it, and the dye is still the same. And that type of fabric was what she was there selling. It was sold to a high-priced, if you will, clientele, and she was well off. We know that she had her own household. There's no mention of a husband, and we know that there were more than a few people living with her. There's no mention that she was a widow. She was a woman in charge and a powerful woman and an opinion leader. And these other women gathered with her to pray. Now, some commentaries say that they were praying to the Hebrew God, and I think they were, but other commentaries say they were probably praying to a number of gods. In Thyatira, they had these trade guilds that you had to be a part of in order to sell fabric. And these trade guilds worshipped a number of different gods, let's say. They had different values and different opportunities, and they kind of did all that together. So these women were praying, but they were also open to the opportunities. And I have to put my head in Lydia's head for just a minute. And I have to see Paul and his friends, probably all male, at least that's the implication, arrive in the middle of my prayer circle on a Sabbath day. And I have to look at him and say, who is this fool and what is he doing here? You know, why? And he says, I'd like to speak to you. And I have to think for a minute that she said, wait a minute. You know, this is my prayer circle, you know. And I'm not sure, you know, we're very protective of our pulpits. You know, we pastors are. We don't just invite anybody or let anybody come in and share for good reason. But she let him speak. And it says that she was listening intently. And I have to think part of the intentionality of her listening was, what is he going to say? You know, he's here with us. We don't know exactly what he's about. And he's going to say something. And what am I going to have to clean up after? I know only once in my career I did it. I regretted it later, but I did it. I stood up and actually corrected somebody's sermon after they preached it. But they had preached it in such a way, and I knew that two of the young women who were there were not coming back to the church again. They were moving to Arizona, and what had been preached could sound one way or it could sound another, and I was worried that they were going to leave that night with the other sermon in their ears, and I didn't want that to happen, so I had to stand up. I wouldn't say I corrected it as so much as I expanded it. Let's be nice about it. The woman that preached that sermon, and I expanded it, is now ordained, praise God. And I knew she would be someday, but we needed to expand that sermon that night. I think the title of the sermon was The Worst Sin. And I thought, oh, that's a hard one to come down to. But I corrected, and I think Lydia might have been listening intently to see what the cleanup was she was going to have to do. But then we hear this: the Lord spoke to her. The Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. She was listening, and the Lord opened her heart. You see, we can talk really well, and we can speak with the tongue of men and of angels, but without love and without the Lord entering in, we're just a resounding gong or clanging cymbal. It takes the Lord's interface. You know, it's not my words. It's not what I have to say. It's not what you have to sing. It's not what we present here in this place. It's what God does in the hearts of the people that are listening, what God does in the hearts of the people that are viewing our sermons later, that makes the difference. God has to move in their hearts to hear what it is that we have to say. And when that happens, things can change. Immediately, she and her household were baptized, and she urged Paul and the travelers with him, saying, "If you had judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my home." And she prevailed upon us. And then at the end of the 16th chapter, we find that Paul goes back after doing some other things. Part of what he did was get locked up. But after he was locked up and all, he went back to Lydia's house again. And Lydia is in some ways a model of what women in the church become. They are the benefactors. They are the people that house those who are traveling. They provide the funding. That's what this tells us. But I have to use what feminists call the hermeneutics of suspicion and think that she's a whole lot more than that. That she was the leader of a group, that she carried this gospel with her back to Thyatira, that she had an opinion circle. And how many of you know that there were just as many women as there were men? And how many of you know that they were more likely to listen to her than they were to any of those other men? That she had more of an opportunity to speak to them, and she had this message that she had heard from the source and was able to take it back with her. It's an impressive story. There's one other thing I want to point out about this story, though. We didn't, you know, I'm going to be known here for reading so much scripture because, you know, we get into the habit of preaching on one or two verses. I don't do that. And even when we have something in the lectionary, I want to go back a little bit. So I want to go back to the sixth verse. When Paul was traveling through the region of Phrygia and Galatia, he was forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. And then as he was nearby my Asia, he attempted to go to Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them. So they passed my Asia, they went to Troas, and that's where Paul had his dream. Some doors have to be closed in order for us to go through the right window. We have more opportunities to do things than we have energy or strength to do them and do them well. And sometimes God has to shut it off. Now, one of the things that's interesting to me about this entire book is that these men we've heard about so far are all moving in the Spirit. And they're all ministering actively. And as they minister actively, they're open to the Holy Spirit saying, "Don't go there." But I think sometimes if we're not in that kind of connection, if we're not walking right along in ministry every day, our ears can get a little clogged up. And the Holy Spirit can be saying, "Don't go there," and we still want to go there. You know, well, I want to go to Asia. You know, God needs to spread this word in Asia. God does need to spread the word in Asia, but you're probably not the one to spread it. You know, but you feel like that needs to happen. I remember when I was right after 30 that I was in a whole bunch of different groups. That just seemed to be my ability. And I was getting elected to the board of everything and anything. I was on the board at church. I was a vice moderator of the board at church. I was on the international team for a prayer group. I was on an international committee for my professional association. I'm not doing this to brag, but I'm just telling you I was over-involved. And I used to think that it was a sign from God anytime I would get elected to something. until I finally realized that that pretty tall blonde boy that I was at the time, I could get elected to anything. That didn't mean it was God's will. You know, I was well-spoken. I had good manners. My mother had taught me well. I was a good communicator. I could get elected to just about anything, but that wasn't God's call on my life. And I was doing a lot of B-minus, C-plus work in all of those organizations because I was stretched too thin. And a couple of weeks ago, I preached on the 23rd Psalm. A time came that God had to make me lay down, you know, push me face first into the grass and say, eat. You know, you don't have time for all this. And I had to resign from the board of the church. And my pastor was not happy with me because we had some of the most contentious board members, incredible saints of God, talented beyond belief, really intentional members of the board, but put them in a room together and they wanted to kill each other. and they especially wanted to kill the pastor. When we did the first evaluation the pastor had in 10 years, I had to say, are you saying that we would ever want to employ this guy? Because, I mean, it was that kind of group. And I was able as vice moderator to be the listener and the balancer and all this. But I resigned from that board. The good thing is that God had three more people to run for the seat that I resigned from. And they had greater talents than I did. And if I'd stayed in that position, I would have stood in the way of the other people that were intended to serve. Instead, I went off and I formed something that we now have here called a ministry support team that was kind of an incubator for new ministries, a chance to help ministries grow. I had to resign from the retreat team that I was on. I had to skip a meeting in Vancouver, Canada. I already had bought the ticket. I had to cancel it, and it was back when you had cancellation fees, so I didn't get all my money back. And I thought I was going to get to go to Vancouver this Sunday summer, but the meeting is in Victoria, not in Vancouver, so I may never get to Vancouver. But I had to step aside and let go of those things to do the thing that God intended for me. There are times that God has to say no to something so that we'll go where we needed to be going. There was this woman named Lydia praying outside the city wall that Paul had an appointment with. He didn't know about it, but if he'd gone here or if he'd gone there, if he'd gone there, he never would have met her. He never would have met those women, and the word would never have been shared. You want to hear something that's ironic? Thyatira is in Asia. He didn't go to Asia, but he met a woman from Asia in Greece, surrounded by some other Greek women, and she, I'm sure, took the word back to Asia, where she probably had a lot more credentials than Paul would have. God had a way. Paul had to make himself available to it, and he did. Now let's switch over quickly to this story of Jesus, because it has a similar theme. You may not have heard it as that, but Jesus is in Jerusalem, and he goes to a pool at the Sheep Gate known as Bethesda, and he's surrounded by individuals experiencing disabilities. I hate the NRSV translation because it calls them invalids. And for all the good stuff and inclusivity that the NRSV version does, I just can't figure out why they would choose that word unless that's what the people believed about themselves. You know, that they believed that they somehow didn't count for anything, that they were no longer important, that all they could do is wait to be healed. That may have been their internal belief. It's still a horrible word, and I just, you know, I want to mark it out and put something else there. NIV says people with disabilities. That's a much better translation, I think, and a much more contemporary understanding. But there were all these people gathered around waiting to be healed. In some tellings of this story, it says that they believe that the first person in the water after the waters are stirred will be healed and nobody else will. So they wait for the waters to be stirred. And some tellings of the story say that it's an angel that's stirring the waters. But at any rate, they're there waiting. And this one individual had been waiting for 38 years. He'd been paralyzed and waiting there for 38 years. And I have to imagine that he moved a little bit over time. You know, that somebody would get healed that was right by the pool, so he would shift over about 2 feet. And then somebody else might die, and he would shift over another 2 feet. So he was gradually getting closer to the pool, but in 38 years, he still was here, and the pool was way over there. And he could just barely see that the waters were moving before somebody was already in the water and experiencing their healing. And so he had a broken spirit, if you will. How many of you know people with broken spirits? I worked in my last job, I was a case manager in a program for formerly homeless folks who were living with HIV and AIDS. And some of them were diagnosed in the early 2000s, and they did not believe that they had a future. You know, at that point, in fact, the whole program was on the premise that we're going to provide free housing for people, we're going to count them as disabled automatically, we're going to, you know, house them in good apartments because they're not going to be with us for very long. And the sad thing with that was one of the things you're supposed to do as a case manager is come up with, help people discover goals for their lives and look into the future. And those people that were diagnosed in the early 2000s just had a really hard time doing that. They had pretty much written off a future, and they were willing to live just in the right now. And they had a nice place to live. I mean, we paid a good level of rent. Some people even had houses because they'd moved into the program early enough. And they had all of that, but they didn't have anything to look forward to. They didn't have any hope of what was out there. There wasn't any goal in their life. And I think this whole courtyard there is probably filled with a whole lot of people like that. And what I want to know is how Jesus could look at that entire courtyard and pick that one man. How he could see all these different needs that were there. Some were paralyzed, I'm sure. Some were blind, it says. Some could not hear. He had all these different needs tugging at him, and he said, "You, do you want to be healed?" You know, I think one of the problems that we have as people is that there are too many good causes, and we can't distinguish between them. There are too many needs, and so we tend to block them all out because we don't want to listen to any of them because they'll break our hearts. You watch that television program ever where they have the magic computer that can find people and crimes just before they happen? Person of interest. I mean, that kind of zeroing in on one thing through all the babble. I have to think that as Jesus stood there, and Jesus healed a number of people that are recorded in the scripture, and we know that he healed people, according to Luke, that aren't even included here, and according to the writer of John, too. But there were many people who didn't get healed. There were many people with needs that Jesus didn't individually address. How did he pick this one? How did he know to go to him and not to somebody else? And then as he goes to the man, he asks the question, do you want to be made well? That's a good question. It's a better question than it sounds like. Do you want to be made well? I ministered with Deb Coggan at Vision of Hope MCC for a long time. We did prayer response time like you did, although we were a little more charismatic. People fell out often when they were prayed over on Sundays. And we had an elaborate system where we had catchers as well as prayers, so they wouldn't splat on the floor when they fell out. You know? And we had cloths to put over people for modesty and all that kind of stuff, all of the charismatic trappings that we have. Deb quit praying to people for a while. And the reason was that she got tired of the same people coming up every Sunday with the same problem, falling out, getting back up, and leaving the same way they came in. She said, do you really want to be healed? And God gave her gift of prophecy, and she would tell people sometimes what it was they needed to do as the next step in order to receive their healing, and it wouldn't happen. And so she said, I'm not going to play this game anymore. She said it publicly. She didn't just say it to the other step. She said, I'm not going to come up here and pray with you every Sunday, and then have you come back the next week to the same time. It's not that God's not working, it's just something that's not happening. So I think the drama of all this is reasons are good. Some of the reasons that it can't happen are true. But he believes that it's not going to happen. And so Jesus gives him three directions, and they're all important. First of all, Jesus says, stand up. Isn't that kind of insulting? I mean, this guy's paralyzed. He's on a mat, drag himself everywhere he goes, and Jesus says, stand up? Yeah, that's kind of a slap in the face. But he did. He stood up. I'm sure he was as shocked as those around him were to see him standing when he would constantly have been falling over before. And then Jesus says, take up your mat. Now that sounds like a simple instruction, clean up after yourself. But it also means that he loses his place in line. That this place that he's worked himself into, you know, from over there to over here, and he's close enough now that he can kind of see the water. But if he takes up his mat, you know the guy over to his left is going to move over. And that he's lost his place in line. Jesus says, give up your place in line. Take up your mat. And then Jesus says, walk. And I have to think he's saying, walk away. Walk away from this place. Walk away from this expectation. You no longer need healing. You've received it. Jesus is very directive in this situation. Sometimes we have to tell people to put on their big person pants, you know? Sometimes we have to tell people, okay, it's time to get serious about this thing. Do you want to be well? And if so, these are the things that you need to do. Now, out of all of these people and all of these needs, Jesus picked this individual. Now, there's another story that follows this around people's objecting to Jesus' healing, which is just incredibly ironic and stupid. But he did it on the Sabbath, and some people thought that the Sabbath was more important than somebody being healed. Sometimes I think we do think our religion is more important than somebody being healed. You know, we think that we need to do things just the right way, or we have to sing the song just the right way, or we have to, you know, use the same ritual every time that we worship together or whatever, that is more important than the people who need to be healed. Well, I don't believe that, and if you ever catch me acting like that, I want you to call me on it. Because nothing that we do here, none of our sacred cows are any more important than the people that have needs. And what we can do to help them is the most important thing that we can do. So I've done all this today. If you looked in your bulletin, you might have been surprised by something with color on it. It was red, a red heart in there. That's symbolic of your heart's cry or your heart's call or what God calls you to be about. I believe as your interim pastor that God has already placed on some of your hearts a need, a people, a possibility, an opportunity. And I want you to trust us enough to share that with us, to write it on that card. You may not have it in mind today. You may not have been given permission to think about this, or you may have already fulfilled it and you're waiting for the next vision or the next dream. But if you have a dream, if you have a thought, if you have an idea, or I'm going to call it a heart's cry, I want you to write it on the heart, and I want you to take it out to the timeline and just stick it up on 2016. And I'm going to keep some of the hearts out there on the table so that even if you don't do it today, you'll have opportunities later to do the same. But I think that God, as we come together as a people, we're going to map some of these together and figure out where God is calling us as a people. But I do trust that God has already placed things on your hearts. If not, I want you to pray for a dream. I want you to pray for a vision. I want you to pray that God will open your eyes and expand what it is that you're seeing and hearing. That you can walk into the midst of a courtyard of conflicting needs, and above it all, you can hear the one need that God intends for you to address, or intends for this place to address. And it doesn't have to be in St. John's. It doesn't have to be in St. John's. It doesn't have to be in MCC, hear me. When we had a ministry incubation team, we used to tell people, you know, come and meet with the team, and they'll talk to you about how to do your ministry. We had a young woman, incredibly talented, incredibly troubled. She had, I think, two or three psychiatric diagnoses, had been hospitalized for most of her teen years into her 20s, had managed to finish college, but was really not somebody that you would build a program on, you might say. And she came to me and had this vision of having a drop-in center for people who were gay and lesbian, bisexual, and transgendered, and others, but primarily that group, that were getting out of mental hospitals that could go and have a place to hang out and to play games and to have support groups. So I knew we could do that at the church. We could provide the space, but it wasn't a ministry of MCC. It wasn't what we, you know, we couldn't get the money that she needed to do that grant. So instead, she came and she met with us, but she went and got a state grant, and now that organization has 5 employees. She's no longer with them, but that dream of hers came true because she was willing to verbalize it, to bring it to a group of people. For the first couple of years, most of the people that were sponsors were members of the congregation, but it got much bigger than us. and it went on beyond her, and it's still there. God planted that dream in her heart, and she verbalized it. She's now got a PhD. She now manages a much larger organization. Very few people know, you know, what everybody knew about her back in the day, because she put that need out there. She equipped that need. She built on it, and that need grew her and changed her life. So I invite you to take the cry of your heart and to share it with the rest of us. Would you pray with me, please? Holy God, we thank you for the dreams and the visions, for the tugs on our heart, for what it is that we hear at times from you. God, open us up to share this. Open us up to flesh this out. Open us up that we might be directed to the thing that will make a difference. In Jesus' name, amen. We have a time of response on Sundays when we pour the waters of baptism, because we know that new life is ours through the waters of baptism. We have prayer with some of the prayer warriors in our congregation for healing of body and mind and spirit. We have an opportunity to receive all that God has to change in this moment. And so I invite you to our time of response to be a part of what God has here for you.
Good morning. My name is Steve. I'm part of the stewardship team. Good morning. When we come up with the stewardship call, we look at it as like two special moments, 2 minutes to reach out to you and to speak to you and to inspire you about how important it is to give, how important it is to serve. And I don't have anything prepared along those lines today. Today I just want to stand up here and to ask you to open your hearts and to give, to support all of the things that are special in here to us, to open your heart and to give and support the vision of the church, the mission and our mission and our continuing ministries. So that's all I'm going to ask you to do today, is just to give sincerely, give openly, and let's give freely today. Jim pointed out to me that there are 2 offerings today. We're going to begin with our general offering first, and we're going to follow that up with a change for change offering supporting the children's ministry. So, thank you.
Gracious and loving God, we thank you once again for the opportunity to continue in this form of our worship through the giving of our tithes and our offerings. We ask, God, that you'll use these tithes and offerings and bless them to continue to go out and do the work that you have started in and through us to share your message of love and your message of hope. In Christ's name, amen. My brothers and sisters, as we gather once more around this table, I want to remind you that at Metropolitan Community Churches we affirm, celebrate, and offer an open communion. For we know that this table represents the fullness of God's unconditional love as demonstrated through the life, ministry, and death, resurrection of the Christ. So on this day, we invite you to come just as you are to share at this table, being nourished by the bread of life and the cup of salvation. This table is open. This table is prepared. This table is open for you. So this morning, we ask that you come just as you are and share at this table. On the night that it was to be handed over to suffering and death, Jesus, during a meal, surrounded by his friends, took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to them gathered there and said, "Take, eat this, all of you. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after the supper, he took a cup of the fruit of the vine, and after giving thanks, he passed it among them and said, "Take, drink this, all of you. This is a cup of a new and everlasting covenant, which is sealed in my blood, which is shed for you and for the world for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat of this bread and you drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let us pray. Loving God, we ask once more for you to pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and fruit of the vine. By your presence, make sacred this feast, that they may become for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us proclaim again the mystery of our faith, that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ is here, Christ will come again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. You're invited as the ushers direct to receive communion from one of the communion servers, followed by a prayer of blessing. If you'd like to receive communion without a prayer of blessing, approach your communion server with your arms crossed across your torso. We ask that you observe the sacredness of this time as others receive the Holy Eucharist through song, prayer, and meditation. Let us all come together now. Let us celebrate the feast. God of grace, we give you thanks once more for this holy mystery you have provided for us through the fruit of the vine and the wheat of the field. Thank you for renewing us at your table by the presence of the Christ. Thank you for the bread of life that sustains all creation. As we prepare to leave this place, may your love continue to surround us and inspire us to live more fully for you, that we might rejoice as your servants to the world. This we ask in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
So as we go today, I invite you to stand up, to pick up your mat, and to walk, to claim all that God has for you, to have dreams, to have visions, to claim those dreams and visions, and to fulfill them in the time that we have. In Jesus' name, amen.
come